Hey guys, welcome back. This is G2 Class Legends Invitational, and the next match will be between G2 Esports Lifecoach and SK Gaming AKAWonder, so a Spanish player which is not maybe so much known in the scene, but he's getting there. And now he has the chance to prove himself against one of the best players in the world. What do you think, Subtle, about this matchup?
Yeah, as you said, Lifecoach definitely on paper the favorite in terms of experience and tournament record, but AKAWonder is a very accomplished player in his own right, especially since joining up with the SK guys. Mm-hmm. He's made a big push. He's qualified for a couple of big majors. He did very well at the Insomnia True Silver Championship. He made top 16 at DreamHack Winter.
Yes,
he actually beat me in the final game when we were both 6-2. So knocked me out one game short of top 16. So I'll try not to bear a grudge for that. I was one savage roar off winning the game against Aggro Druid. Didn't quite have it.
Savage.
Yeah, absolutely savage. But yeah, Wonder is a very, very accomplished player. Definitely starting to make his name for himself and starting to pick up those invites to these sorts of big premier events. So he's definitely going to want to make a push here, but. I don't know. I'm still reeling from that Worgen Warrior. I just want to see Crane versus Zetalot just right now. I just want to see it. Like, come on, let's go.
Two more matches, man.
Yeah, okay.
Two more matches, and then we're back to the Worgen Warrior and the Priest. So I guess the two most interesting decks in the tournament, I would say, right? At least from my perspective, unless someone brought something more interesting and it's still concealed that we didn't see. The next upcoming match, what I also want to recap yesterday was kind of a shaky performance by AKAWonder yesterday, right? When he was playing against Paladin, against Marcus Kennedy Paladin, there was some overextending and over trading by AKAWonder's Zoo deck, which was completely unnecessary and wasn't oppressive enough to win and secure the wins as soon as possible, right? It might be a problem against a druid in general, right? Because in theory, Zoo is favored against Zoo. Zoo is favored against druid.
Yeah.
But if AKAWonder will do the same mistake that he was doing yesterday, this might cost him the game. Because if he goes into trading too much and the trades will be not favorable, like by using Abusive Surgeons, POs, getting the instant benefits of breaking an egg as soon as possible, then he might get punished for that.
Yeah, absolutely. His game against Mark Kennedy, Mark Kennedy obviously wasn't the most experienced Hearthstone player. I wasn't quite sure what level we were to expect from him, but honestly, that was a series that a player of AKAWonder's standing should have probably taken down 3-0. And he let one game slip, as you said, just by being a little bit passive, not really playing optimally with his Zoo deck. So he's going to have to tighten things up today a little bit if he's going to take down Lifecoach. I guess it's worth noting, I'm just going to plug this one more time for you, Lothar, that if you guys have anything to say about the tournament so far, any of the decks, what your favorite deck is, what you're looking forward to, who you think is going to win the tournament, any of that good stuff, you can tweet using the hashtag G2CL and possibly get your tweets featured on stream, which, I mean, that's what everyone wants to do, right? Like, it's like donating to a streamer, but it doesn't cost you any money. Like, why wouldn't you do this? Come on.
Wow. The e-fame, right?
Yeah, exactly.
It would be really cool to hear opinions about the format, because for me, it seems like it's either very interesting or mildly boring. It's like, right? The matches are like kind of on both ends of the stick, right? They are so super hyped about the matchups because they're so unusual. It's something that you don't see in other tournaments, or they are just, unfortunately, like Mirror of Druids or Mirror of Zeus. Or, order that type of stuff. But, talking about Zoo and Druid, Lifecoach opens with a Dionysus Aspirant, which is one of the best cards against Zoo in general right now. Apart from Innervate Keeper, I think Dionysus Aspirant is the best opener. Because Living Roots is not that great against Voidwalkers, gets directly countered by that. So Dionysus Aspirant seems to be the weapon of choice, the hard mulligan for, right? Unless, of course, you have Innervate and Wildgrowth in your hand.
Yeah, for sure. We see from Wanda's side that Acidic Swampoos, which did do a decent amount of work for him yesterday in the Paladin matchup, not going to be useful at all here against the Druid. Just kind of a Bloodfen Raptor, 3-2 for 2 mana. Not really what you want in this situation. You'd rather have the sticky Deathrattle minions that you can then start trading up. He's just going to play it out on the board here to try and contest that Darnassus Aspirant, but the Innervate Sludge Belcher shuts that down, forces him to use the Owl to pick up the trade.
And that's awesome for Lifecoach, because he's building the board presence slowly but steadily.
Yeah.
Now he's in the... That's very interesting to see, because usually it's the other way around. The Zoo has multiple minions on board that have stats like 3-2, 2-2, and the Druid is staring at them and saying, well, what can I do? I'll just play the Druid with the Claw Taunt mode and hope there's no big, there's no PO or Abuse of Certain.
Mm-hmm.
Right? But this is now turning around. But Lifecoach is missing a 4-drop. Or even a 2-drop. Anything to do on turn 4.
Yep. Anything. And the Druid deck is sometimes a little light on 4-drops. You only really have the Shredders as proactive things to do on turn 4. But even the Keeper here would have been fantastic just to play on curve and silence that Void Caller. So he's whiffed completely on his 4-mana cards. He's going to have to take a hero power pass turn. And he's going to decide here whether he wants to call the bluff on that Void Caller, I guess. But I am
I don't think so. You want
yeah,
to.
Yeah, I don't think so either. I think it's pretty dangerous. And I think we'll just end up going face here.
Yeah, that would be my guess too. I mean, you, of course, conceal this Shade of Naxxramas.
Yes.
Because that's... Yeah. It's very similar situation to when you play against... When you did play against Handlocks. The Shade of Naxxramas was one of the minions that could get you to the point when you combo out your opponent from a, well, let's say, bigger amount of health than 14. Or the other purpose of the minion was to kill a giant straight away.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. It looks like he is going to take the trade here. Wow, Doomguard is going to come out onto the board with initiative. So I guess the consideration here is that if he doesn't make that hero power turn this turn, then he's also kind of forced to hero power on the next turn if he wants to deal with the Void Caller, because it will just take the free trade into the 3-3.
Mm-hmm.
I guess he's just his plan was, you know, I'm probably going to draw a playable card next turn for 4 or 5 mana. I have a good chance of doing that. And I won't want to hero power. And there is the Druid of the Claw that would have prevented the hero power on this turn, but still, pulling that Doomguard out onto the board is pretty devastating.
Yep, I agree. Wow. This is not looking good for Lifecoach right now. Even though he had a really good opening board and good turn 1, 2, 3, he missed on the 4. And imagine if he would have anything to play on turn 4. Then he would not make the choice, probably would not make the choice of killing the Void Caller and wouldn't summon the Doomguard for 0 mana, because that was disastrous. That might be the reason why the game is already lost. Because fortunately for him, he has the Force of Nature. So he might be able to clean up the board this turn. But now let's see if it's better for AKAWonder to just play the Sea Giant or go for the Knife Juggler into the Implosion. It seems okay to go with the Knife Juggler Implosion because it's the best possible turn in theory. But if Lifecoach has a swipe, then you're in a pile of trouble.
Yep.
You're in a pickle.
Especially if you end up having to trade the Doomguard into the Druid of the Claw afterwards, if the knives don't take it out, you will end up with a 5-3 Doomguard and then a 3-2 on the board and a bunch of 1-1s, so the swipe will clear that perfectly with the hero power. There is also a very, very risky play where he could have implosioned the 4-6, and if it had rolled 4, he is able to play the Sea Giant for 2 mana alongside it.
Mm-hmm.
Any other result from the implosion wouldn't have let him play the Sea Giant in that situation, though. So I like him just getting the AA on board here.
He's getting only punished by Big M Hunter.
Yes. But the alternate play, you know, gets punished by Swipe. There's 2 Swipes in the deck. There's only 1 Big Game Hunter. So this play is less likely to get punished statistically. And also you keep the resource of the implosion in your hand. And resources, like removal spells, are much better resources to have in your hand than minions, if you're looking at like which you want to value more. So the fact that this gets punished less often, just statistically based on the cards in the deck, combined with the fact that you keep an important card back in your hand, probably just comes out at this being the better play overall.
Yeah, And you have to consider it's a 8-8 for 6 mana.
Yes.
So, sounds like a good minion, right?
Mm-hmm.
You probably would have played that in a deck, if that would be the possible minion to play, right? Especially before someone plays a Dr. Boom, in example.
Yeah, for sure. So Lifecoach again with just a pretty sad turn. He's missed a bunch of minions here, been sat with that double Savage Roar in hand.
Oh my god.
And the Dr. Boom draw here. This is quickly spiraling out of control for Lifecoach. AKAWonder just generating such a huge board here.
Hmm.
I mean, he's considering his options, but I mean,
I don't see anything else.
Dr. Boom, trade the Sea Giant, face with the Doomguard. I mean, come on, that has to be the play, right?
Yeah, and you have 16 damage, 20, 22 damage staring at your opponent next turn. So if Lifecoach won't remove any minions, he's dead. And even if he removes some of the minions, then he's still in a better position. Because he is trading his tempo and his board control, and he's losing the board control in the process after the turn because that gives the initiative back to AKAWonder.
Yep. So after much deliberation, Wonder does decide that he's going to slam Dr. Boom here on turn 7, pushes the damage with the Doomguard. He is now just threatening lethal on the board, and some sort of defensive play is going to come down here. I don't think Lifecoach can get away with Dr. Boom, even if he trades into the Sea Giant with his 6-6, which doesn't feel great anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So he is probably going to have to make a Force of Nature play, but that, I mean, the numbers that are on the board, the Force of Nature just doesn't interact with it particularly well either. All these odd numbers in play right now.
Yep. I was thinking about the Wrath for one last turn.
Yeah.
Right? Because it would have helped if the Wrath would have dealt 3. He could have killed the Boom Bots as well. Now with the Force of Nature and trade for the with the Giant.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Force of Nature comes down and it's going to be awkward no matter what he does. Chooses to take out the Giant.
How much damage will go to his face? Because I'm sure as hell it will hit his face and probably end the game in the process.
Yeah, I mean, he has 8 damage left, so he can choose to trade for the Dr. Boom if he likes, but he's going to choose to trade for the Doomguard here, at least keep a 6-1 in play, which trades at best for a Boombot.
I'm quite interested in the reasoning. Seems like you have no way of winning the game if you do that.
Yeah. But at the same time, like, he's at 8 mana next turn, so even going face, like, he's not on a Savage Roar draw to win the games, he just doesn't have the mana to play it, so I think this is just kind of a catch-22 situation for Lifecoach. Like, both plays were just losing plays, putting damage to the face and trading, so he just decides to trade as efficiently as he possibly could, even though that efficiency only cost his opponent an extra Boombot of value, which then just does extra damage to the face anyway. And there is possible lethal here, right? Knife juggler,
you can
knife
juggle your own bomb.
So on average, that does 2.5 plus 3 damage, 5.5 damage. Yeah, probably not worth going for. All
right. Well, he's going for it.
Oh, my God.
He's going for the flash of play.
The egg, I think, instead. No.
It's free. So now he needs 4 damage from the bomb.
Yep.
And.
Oh my God!
Well, that worked.
Sure.
So, it was a 66% into a 25%. No, you can't count it like that because four. No, you can't actually because it's always even if you hit four damage on implosion and only generates 3 minions.
Right. Yeah.
And you get one more. No, you don't. Never mind.
So yeah, he could have made that play like a little bit safer on the board by implosioning his own Nerubian Egg just to like generate a bigger board. But I mean, I guess he just wanted to go for the style points. Obviously, he's on stream right now. He wants to wave to his mom and say, "Hey, look, check out how cool I am. Look at my plays." but yeah, I mean, it worked out. So you can't fault him for it. He goes with the style option, implosion on the Boombot for lethal. Definitely style points for Wonder if nothing else, but we'll see if he can continue this momentum, take down more games here.
Well, his favorite in the matchup.
Yes.
And now let's see what Lifecoach will do, because it's really interesting to see the mulligan from Druid player against the Zoo, because sometimes it's different from what you would usually do. That was swipe in hand.
Pretty good. Coin Wild Growth into Shade into double swipe. Means he'll be able to protect his Shade on the board, theoretically, for a reasonable amount of time. Definitely not a bad opening hand to have. Like you said, the key cards are quite often Keeper of the Grove and Innovate more than Wild Growth, but this is a hand that can definitely do some work here.
Well, now he has a permanent half on an Innovate, basically a permanent coin.
Yep.
Every single turn, and he can Cure Vowed, so it's way better. And he has the X to swipe, which is also very important. So it all depends what will AKAWonder do next turn, because if Lifecoach will play the Shade of Maximus, and I'm sure he will, then AKAWonder has an option, if he takes a one drop, to try his chances to snipe it. Okay, there's no. Well, he can still go for the peddler.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to say, I love this knife juggler from AKAWonder because, you know, you expect Shade of Naxxramas. We went through the options before of what coin Wild Growth can possibly mean, but the most common one is Shade of Naxxramas. So not only does the knife juggler punish him hardest for that, and just in terms of doing maximum damage to face, it also does give him the option, if he wants to go for it, for the 25% snipe on the Shade with the peddler into a one-drop minion.
Yep. Well, would you do it, or are you going for the safe option?
It looks like AKAWonder values the more solid option with the Imp Gang boss on the board. Can't really fault him too much for it. Obviously, you have to be offered a minion, so you can't, you know, if you get like the Soulfire Power Overwhelming Mortal Coil option or something like that, then there's no option available. And then even if you do get a minion, you kind of have to take the 25% anyway, and then you're probably a little bit exposed to swipe because you've just probably played a one health minion if you picked up a one drop. So there's a lot of negatives to that situation, but obviously the perfect world, you know, the perfect world, like when you implosion your own boombot and get lethal, for example, the perfect world works out incredibly for him there if he does snipe it down.
Well, it looks like you have to go with the Pilot Shredder, because otherwise, like, I mean, you're punished by the implosion heavily. Most likely will clear up your board. What else do you do? If you go for the rep on the Knife Juggler, you have to Hero Power the Voidwalker to 2 HP, and then you count on a Keeper of the Grove from the top of the deck.
Yeah, doesn't feel too great. I definitely don't feel like you want to reveal that Shade yet. So yeah, the Wrath would be a very, very passive turn, but Lifecoach, as always, is evaluating the relative merits, and it looks like he is going to go for the passive turn here.
Interesting.
But I mean, can you attack with the Shade? I guess if you attack with the Shade and the Imp Gang boss goes back in, that does set up for the swipe on the following turn. But no, he is going to use the Hero Power. Okay.
Yeah. So he relies on a top deck, basically, I would say, in this situation. Is he? Maybe not. Maybe he's setting up a 2-turn swipe. Like a swipe back-to-back.
Yeah, sure, that can make some sense, but this Nerubian Egg is going to put a little bit of a crimp in that plan, because if he does swipe back-to-back, he's going to end up popping that egg, so Power Overwhelming, pretty easy pickup from the Dark Peddler there as well, just alongside two pretty low-value minions, and when you're jamming a Nerubian Egg on the board, Power Overwhelming is the first thing that you're looking for.
Mm-hmm. Innovate doesn't help this time. It seems like this is the turn when you actually played it. Shredder, right? Because there's no more knife juggler on board, so you're not so afraid of the implosion. Even if your opponent plays the implosion, then you have the swipe afterwards.
Yep.
There's the second knife juggler. But second. I guess it's better to just play low tip and shut down these potential swipes, the potential living roots, the potential almost every single possibility, right?
Yeah, if you Lurtheb, you do present some pretty nice trades on the board for your opponent, though, which is probably the concern here. I kind of like the Lurtheb to go for maximum aggression there. This play that he's made here has just set up a pretty glorious swipe for his opponent.
Yep, and that's the problem. Well, it's maybe not the best one. Okay, maybe you can use an Innovate alongside it.
Pretty good, right? Like you swipe the 4/4 Hero Power, swipe the 4/4, trade the Shade into the 1/1, and then Hero Power the Juggler.
Okay, that's not bad, but unfortunately, I wanted to say that there's a chance that your minion will get killed. Oh, double swipe!
Alright, Lifecoach is just going in deep this turn. Double swipe is a full board clear, allows his shade to be free on the board. The only thing this now gets punished by is high roll implosion. Can get owled, but that will still leave it on the board, so not really a true punish. And yeah, AKAWonder now, from the double swipe, finds himself in trouble.
Yeah, that was a really... Oh my god. A good turn for Lifecoach, but unfortunately, back-to-back innovates. When it's really low on cards, it's not a good draw, unless next turn it will be a Ancient of Lore drawn from the top of the deck. Would you play the Big Game Hunter when you know that your opponent plays Sea Giant and Dr. Boom in his deck?
Yeah, it's a tricky one. Against most common zoos these days, you would just play the Tempo BGH, because especially in Europe, most of the zoos are just topping out at Doomguard and Loetheb these days. But we've seen from Wanda, as you said, the Sea Giant and the Dr. Boom, as well as the Voidcaller and Mal'Ganis that he has in there as well, as he just draws the Voidcaller. So.
Oh yeah, right, he has the Mal'Ganis too.
Yeah.
Correct.
Yeah, so that Big Game Hunter does actually have a ton of targets, but Lifecoach is just valuing the tempo right now. He knows he needs a minion in play to be competitive against what Zoo will play here, and it's actually going to work out pretty well against either the Imp Gang boss or the Voidcaller that Wanda can choose to play this turn.
We have to bear in mind that the Living Roots is actually 2 damage to the face.
Yep.
It's an Arcane Shot. Or a Hunter Hero Power for half the cost.
Yeah, so, but with greatly added flexibility on top of that. Such a strong card, Living Roots, right? Like, it's an innocuous card. It's not one that people looked at and went, whoa, this card is crazy. But, like, in terms of the flexibility that it gives you, it's just such a strong card overall.
But AKAWonder needs to play the taunt this turn. He's just getting too low.
Yeah, agreed.
Oh, he goes face? No way.
He's thinking about it.
That is so risky.
It is. Wow!
So he makes the complete opposite decision of what he was making yesterday, and Lifecoach whiffs 3rd time in a row!
Yep.
Wow, this looks like magic when he draws four lands in a row. I'm just like, yeah, I guess I'm losing this game.
What do you do here? Living Roots plus the BGH goes into the Loetheb, I guess, and then
he kills the one
trade. Yeah.
Huh. Interesting.
It's literally all you can do this turn, unless you want to wild growth yourself to 10 mana, but it looks much more valuable as a cycle if the game goes that far at this point.
AKAWonder is now pushed to use the PO, unless he will get a Abusive Surgeon.
Doomguard top deck is lethal, right? 6, 11 damage, yeah?
Yeah, right.
Doomguard would have been lethal.
But you can't play the Flame Imp. It's putting you in range of... Actually, doesn't put you in range of anything.
No, if you tap and play Flame Imp, then you're in range of just Force of Nature.
Oh, wow, that tap.
Yeah.
Did you see that coming?
I think I probably would have tapped in that situation, yeah. Just you're in the situation where you're dead to combo anyway, and this only really opens you up to being dead to Force of Nature, and then even then only if you play the Flame Imp as well. So, yeah, I think I'm fine with this.
Oh, huge All draw right. for Lifecoach. This puts him back into the game. And a Rav. And a Savage Roar. That doesn't do much. Hero Power Phase. Pass the turn.
Looks like he might be planning to cycle the Rav here, try and dig deeper for that Force of Nature that he needs to definitely seal the game. But I can see some merit in Hero Power Phase as well. Just swing the health by 2 more this turn. Gain one more life yourself. Put 1 more damage on the Warlock.
Well, will it change the situation if your opponent will tap? Because if he will tap, he will be at 7.
Mm-hmm.
So he still dies to Force of Nature and Hero Power. But you have Savage Roar in hand. So the Force of Nature draw isn't that important, right?
Oh, he was so close to the Power Overwhelming Doomguard last turn.
Uh-huh. That was really close. So, the Savage Roar deals 2 damage, even without a minion right now. If you want to be 100% sure of having a way to clear the Ancient of Law, you need to play Flame Imp and deal 3 damage to yourself. Because then you will have Doomguard and you double trade into it.
We can just play the Doomguard and trade into it, right? And just keep your 3-4 on the board. You don't need to go through double trade thing. Yeah.
Oh my god, that was really stupid. Sorry for that.
Yeah, it's just an awkward hand to have a Doomguard with, because you don't really want to play either of these cards before you Flame Imp. So, before you Doomguard. It's going to tap. Argus.
Wait, wasn't it just better to play the Doomguard, as you said?
I guess he's just trying to hold on to one of these cards now and keeps the Flame Imp. So that Void Caller does still have some value to it, but that Flame Imp is the one card that he's almost certainly not playing.
And it's Force of Nature!
Alright.
From the top of the deck, there was still a chance to get another draw from the Wild Grove. But here we go. On the back of two swipes, I would say. Without those two swipes, there will be no possible way of making a comeback from that board.
Right. The double swipe play was huge. Just maximum aggression from Lifecoach, spending the two swipes and the innovate just to have his unanswered Shade of Naxxramas on the board. And we saw that Shade was still sticking around like two turns later, still, you know, it dealt damage to face like another time, I think, and then traded into an Imp Gang boss. So definitely a huge recognition of Lifecoach of how much value that Shade could bring to him in the long term, using up his two huge removal cards to take to.
Okay, so now for AKAWonder, I'll probably keep the Voidwalker and Voidcaller, because the Voidwalker is a counter against the Living Roots, and Voidcaller has so much value against Druids in general, because they require the Keeper to silence them. But the Keepers would probably like to kill a 2-drop instead.
Yeah.
Instead of the silence. So it's a problematic minion for Lifecoach in general. And now AKAWonder has the perfect curve also. 1, 2, 3, 4. Oh.
Yep.
There's the Innervate.
Innervate does make some possibilities happen here.
It makes sense to play the Shade this turn, right?
Yeah, I think so. Innervate Shade into Wrath on turn 2 looks to be your natural curve here. Lifecoach, as always, considering all his options. But does end up innovating out of the Shade Naxxramas. No big surprise there. Now, suddenly, you're in a situation where do you even want to play this Voidwalker?
I don't think you want to play it.
At this point, if you play it, the Shade Naxxramas can just free trade into it, and there's no possible answer that you can have to take it off the board this early, so it just gets to stick around, pick up an immediate 2-for-1 against your minions, and it even just plays straight into the Wrath that Lifecoach may be wanting to do this turn. So
the only reason to play it right now is because you have two Void Colors and you want to have a 100% good Death Rattle from it.
Sure. Yeah, makes sense.
And you want to unshade. You want to force your opponent to unshade, right? But that's the only reason I see. Those are the two reasons I see here. But I would say that Lifecoach values the Wrath a lot, especially that he's whiffing on turn 3. So he wants to have the Wrath available next turn. So probably we're going to trade and Hero Power this turn just by having the opportunity to clear a minion on turn 2 from AKAWonder with his Wrath.
Yeah, makes a lot of sense. We'll see what Lifecoach chooses to go with here. Looks like he is going to reveal the Shade. And like I said, this is safe at this point, because the only possible interaction that Zoodek can have with this early is Iron Beak Owl, or like the outside opportunity for, say, Dark Peddler Coin Soulfire is the only option.
Oh my god.
That Mal'Ganis is huge, though. He'll be able to play out the Imp Gang boss on turn 3. To get that out of his hand, but he is always going to have to take the 50-50 with the two Void Callers unless he gets enough time to develop both Void Callers onto the board. But the potential of that Mal'Ganis coming out here is massive, and Lifecoach's play to hold the Wrath on the previous turn is paying dividends here, because it now allows this Shade of Naxxramas to dominate even further.
Mm-hmm. Dark Petal can get you a Soulfire to get rid of the Shade of Naxxramas, but Void Caller, he's going for the 33% Mal'Ganis.
Wow. I mean,
and based on what Lifecoach was doing last game, I'm guessing he wants to trade again.
Yeah, I mean, that would be consistent with his thinking in the previous turn, but it looks like if he's wild growthing first,
then he's not doing it, right?
He's going to go face, okay.
Because he would wait for the outcome of the Death Rattle and then maybe use the swipe.
Yep, exactly. So this gives AKAWonder a chance to set up his hand a bit more favorably here if he would like to, but it looks like he's going to go...
Ghost Warrior, Abyss of Sergeant? Elven Archer!
Elven Archer is good
that,
enough. Yep.
It was, right? It
has 4 health, HP. 4 health shield.
Oh my god.
Alright, I mean, this is everything here. If he gets the Mal'Ganis, he's in such a good position. Imp Gangboss comes back.
Imp Gangboss.
He does have another chance, but now the Keeper of the Grove is in hand, so that second Void Caller may not be able to get value. And we may have to wait to get this Mal'Ganis out the hard way. But even so, he's in a very, very comfortable position here. And that Keeper might even be forced to be used this turn to take out the 2-2. Otherwise, he can just swipe down the Imp Gang boss and Hero Power the 2-2 to get an effective ball clear.
Mm-hmm. Agree. We'll see what the Lifecoach will do. He seems to be sometimes, you know, having different opinions. But usually he's correct. So let's see what he will do. He'll, of course, take his time, because that's what Lifecoach does. It's probably the situation, even though there was no implosion plate yet, I think you go for the swipe. Right?
I think so. I mean, there's just too much danger of buffs coming out if you play the Keeper of the Grove, but yeah, again, Lifecoach seems to disagree. You're really scared of, say, an Abusive Sergeant onto the Imp Gang boss, but I guess since you saw your opponent dig with Dark Peddler on the previous turn, you know that he doesn't have a buff card like that in hand, because he had to use the Dark Peddler to pick one up to be able to kill the Shade. So maybe that's your thinking here, but still, you do just let your opponent start getting some immediate value out of the Imp Gang boss here if he wants to, but yep. You have kept that swipe in hand to be able to deal with it, so... Yeah.
And there's the possibility of Mal'Ganis, but of course Lifecoach doesn't know that. So he saw one Void Caller, and my guess is that if you see one Void Caller, you're not predicting the second one.
Right.
And this is why Lifecoach did use the Keeper, just to gain the tempo, right? Because he killed a minion. And this is something we talked about like 3 turns before, right? Usually the Keeper against a Zoo wants to deal the damage instead of silencing something, unless it's an Ruben Egg.
Yeah, it makes a lot of sense, but from Wonder's side here, he's just seen the Keeper come down, so he's probably fairly comfortable that Void Caller will get value, but the on-curve play here is just the lower third, but also protects from the swipe just a little bit. Just a little bit, 9 mana swipe, pretty hard to cast in this situation.
Yeah, but it's 10-7. Usually that's Dr. Boom on Ancient of Law.
Mm-hmm. But if it is Ancient of Law, you know, the lower third obviously isn't going to block any spells on turn 7 most commonly, but if the play is Ancient of Law, it's kind of nice just to have the 5-5 body in play just to be able to deal with the Ancient of Law straight away.
Especially if you will draw a Defender of Argus.
Yes.
You trade with the 1-1, so your opponent is in a difficult situation to pick the 2-1 off. Now you've been egg.
It's a decent draw. Helps him curb out with the Void Caller here, if that's the line that he wants to go down.
Yep, agree. Seems like Void Caller and Urban Egg double trade.
Yeah, seems fair. I mean, he's in a kind of awkward position here, because as the aggressive deck in the matchup, he is significantly behind on life, but he's starting to get a commanding board presence.
This is the turn when he can turn the board around.
Yeah. And still, even though a lot of cards have been drawn since that first opportunity for Mal'Ganis to enter the board, we still see there's no big game hunter in hand, but Emperor is a pretty nice pickup.
Yep, you drop it right now. 3 mana swipe is a huge deal. The same goes for the Druid of the Claw, because now you have an access to Druid of the Claw, Savage Roar, and swipe in the same turn.
Yes, you do. And even beyond that, like this Emperor just requires an answer. Power Overwhelming will help to get the job done, but he is probably going to have to tap to try and find enough stuff to do with the rest of his turn. He can Imp Gang Boss.
He can play the Mal'Ganis this turn.
Right.
You can play Imp Gang Boss, PO the Egg,
yeah.
Sacrifice both minions, you get a 4-4 right. And a Mal'Ganis, so your Imp Gang Boss is a 4-6.
Right, but you still have enough mana left to tap at the end, right? So...
Yeah, but you want to commit to the play first, right?
Yeah. You want to get the immunity Mal'Ganis in play first, then you tap, and then you find out what your options are, for sure. But the tap is going to happen either way. Good ordering. Doesn't have to commit to the Power Overwhelming yet. He might pick up an Abusive Sergeant off the tap, which will let him get the job done more efficiently, keep a Power Overwhelming in hand. But Yep, this is a pretty disgusting board right now, and no big game hunter in hand still for Lifecoach. Aspirant is not going to do anything in this situation.
Is he forced to use the Druid of the Claw and swipe to kill it? Wow.
So miserable though, because you start spawning 1/1s from the imp gang boss in the meantime, and you've just used your swipe, so those 1/1s are likely to stick around on the board for a decent amount of time. But how else are you going to answer that Mal'Ganis? You can put up the wall with Druid of the Claw and Sludge Belcher, but they just immediately get traded out of the game, and you just pass all the initiative back to your opponent. So, yeah, I mean, I'm struggling to see a good play here from Lifecoach. We'll see what he comes up with. I'm sure the Emperor turn on the previous turn was probably the quickest turn he's played in this entire tournament, but outside of that, he's going to have to put his thinking cap on here. Druid of the Claw is going to come down, so it looks like he is going to go for the clear play. Yeah,
he's committing to that. Unfortunately for him, because that's so much investment. Such a big investment.
Yeah, it is. And the bad news for him is that the pressure is really not going to be relieved that much here, because Dr. Boom is just going to come straight back down onto this board. Oh, and they can followed up by a Sea Giant. On the next turn, the hits keep on coming here for AKAWonder, and just this lack of big game hunter for Lifecoach. Still no big game hunter.
Well, Wild Growth first.
Yep. Wild Growth definitely happens this turn. He can even choose to cycle the Wrath afterwards.
Well, if you are not planning to use Wild Growth first, what is your plan? Wrath, Darnassus, Hero Power, Sludge Belcher, right?
Yeah, so Wild Growth definitely happens. Let's see what he draws here. He's just begging for that big game hunter. Keeper of the Grove doesn't really help.
That was needed the game before. The turn before. Actually, two turns before. He's going for the cycle.
Yeah, I think Lifecoach knows he has to hit the big game hunter.
Sludge Belcher or Hero Power first and Angel Drake. I was thinking about Sludge Belcher and Darnassus Aspirant.
Right.
So that's a Darnassus Aspirant anyway. But that makes a setup for the bomb. Well, that was quite interesting. If he wants to kill the bomb.
I'm interested as to why he played the Drake there instead of the Sludge Belcher anyway, because even if he drew the big game hunter at that point, he couldn't play it with the two remaining mana he had, so playing the Drake on the following turn still allows him to big game hunter at the same point. So I feel like the defensive player, the Sludge Belcher, would have been a little bit stronger there, but he just kept on digging through his deck. He wants to try and draw the maximum amount of cards, and Sea Giant gonna come down here. Defender of Argus, a pretty nice pickup here to go
well,
with it.
Well, you can get a free tap, right? You generate only one minion, so it's for four mana, so it's still the one mana difference is not something you want.
Yeah, and I guess if he's playing the Sea Giant first, his intention is just to taunt the two huge minions here. He's taunting the Sea Giant, but he's going to use the Imp Gang boss as well, so this makes sense too. Obviously, he could have saved a mana on the Sea Giant, not that it would have been particularly relevant, but he could have saved a mana on the Sea Giant by playing the Argus first, but his intention was to taunt the 9-9 or taunt the A8, so.
Well, this sucks. Azure Drake into Big Game Hunter. Help with the 9-9.
Yep. Nope. That's still not it. The Big
16,
Game Hunter just
16, 18, 20, 23 damage possible.
Oh boy. Lifecoach is in trouble here. Belcher has to come down just for some security against not dying, but it's just going to get traded out so easily by this board. Iron Beak out, tap for lethal.
There's no way you can die even if you tap.
Yep. So... yeah, you're behind a 9-9 taunt and a 3-3 taunt, and you're still well above the Force of Nature Savage Roar combo benchmark anyway. So yeah, we're going to tap for lethal here, I'm sure of it.
And one off.
Well, we still see what the Boombot does, I guess. I mean, we know Wonder is a big fan of winning games with Boombots, so let's see what happens here. Face 4-2. No.
It always goes to Azure Drake, man.
Yeah, that's true.
The unwritten rule. Death Rattle, deal 1-4 damage. If Azure Drake is present on the board, kill it instead.
Abusive Sergeant gonna come down. He's gonna use his little guys to trade here by the looks of things. Just trade the 3-1 and the 2-3 in. Maximize his amount of taunt on the board. Smash in the damage from the huge minions, and I don't see a card in Hearthstone that would get him out of this right now, apart from, of course, the infamous...
Force of Nature, what I want to say. Twisting Nether.
Twisting Nether would do it, and of course the infamous Deathwing, which is always the go-to casting card, right? It's like, oh, what does he need here? Always Deathwing.
That's about it. 2-1 for AKAWonder. He takes the lead. He has the advantage. I'm really curious what Lifecoach has. Which druid is Lifecoach sporting in the second slot? Right? Is it the aggro druid? Does it have better chances against Zoo?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. We talked yesterday that the G2 guys are very famous for preparing together and coming up with something that they all agree on to be the best lineup. And we saw that Tice had aggro druid and midrange druid as his two decks. So I would suspect that maybe Lifecoach does have aggro druid as his other deck, but maybe he's just more comfortable as a midrange druid player. I think the aggro druid is a slightly better matchup than the midrange druid, but... maybe he's just more comfortable as a mid-range druid player, and he's going to continue queuing up the matchup that he knows.
This time he has the opening with the Living Roots, and there's no Void Walker to counter that.
Isn't. In fact, AKAWonder is just kind of short of sticky minions in general here. He just kind of has the vanilla stats minions, 3-2 on the Ooze, 3-2 on the Knife Juggler, so...
In a bit!
This Roots is going to be able to pick up some value here.
If Lifecoach would have picked an Innovate here to play the Keeper of the Grove, that would be such a huge swing.
Yeah.
Incredible swing in board position. Wow, and Lifecoach probably is pushed to use the hero power again? No, he's not. He's sticking to it. So there's no way of implosion on turn 3, of course. So he knows there will be practically two juggles possible. Yeah. So the chances of hitting twice the Shadow Maxanas are slim. And he has the option to Keeper the Knife Juggler next turn.
Yeah, it looks really solid. Well, again, these...
he had the option to also kill the spider and then swipe, but that will generate two knives. It's not the perfect scenario.
Yeah, you could potentially lose your Shade in that situation, so... definitely a pretty risky play, and the Keeper of the Grove was just so clean there to take out the Knife Juggler. Don't blame him for this play at all. And again, we see the double swipe draw, so Lifecoach is getting access to the cards he needs in this matchup. He's getting his early board presence with the Living Roots, the Shades, and the Keeper, and then he's drawing into the swipes that he needs for mid-game removal. So this game is looking fairly promising for Lifecoach at the moment.
Probably favored the Sarge Belch in this situation because it doesn't put a way of the Void it doesn't give an option without the silence for AKAWonder to sacrifice it, right? Unless you use the PO on it. But then you can't take advantage of a Doomguard generated this turn because you can't attack with it because
right.
It's already end of the turn. If you play Azure Drake, then you won't attack with the Shade of Naxxramas. If you play Belcher, then you attack with the Shade of Naxxramas. He goes for the swipe in this case, right? Does he? No.
Plays the counter.
Okay. So Lifecoach chooses the, I would say, safest route.
Yeah, so by going Shade of Naxxramas hero power, it makes sense to pop the creeper, because that way you actually have a target for your hero power instead of just swinging at face. But I agree with you. I think the Belcher was pretty solid there, just to wall out the board a little bit. But I think Lifecoach has recognized that you can get a lot of value out of Shades in this matchup because Zoo just can't really interact with them. So if you get them down early enough when you're not really under any real pressure, then they can actually create you a pretty big advantage later on in the game.
Well, now you can't really play this Sludge Belcher because it's dead to the low tab. If you play Belcher, then you need to kill the 1-1 with one of the Shades. If you play the Azure Drake, you can't attack with any of the Shades. So it seems like the Belcher is the go-to option here. Because you have to... Imagine that you would top deck or get a innervate from the Azure Drake, and you have access to a 5 damage swipe with 2 damage AoE.
Mm.
And I think that might be game breaking, right? In this situation, he goes for Azure Drake this turn. Interesting to see. So he values the advantage of having a 4/4 minion that has effect on the board right now, so he will get the second value from Belcher. I mean the value from the Belcher next turn immediately because of the taunt keyword. And it also, if he trades with, if he pushes AKAWonder to trade with the low tip to Azure Drake, then he setups a good swipe.
Yeah, I think that's the key point here, is that he does offer up a good trade with the lower third into the Azure Drake, but if that happens, one of those two swipes in hand is going to be really, really potent. But AKAWonder senses the bait, is going to use the 1-1 to trade in instead, using the power overwhelming, and just start being aggressive and pushing the damage to face using these small little 1-3
swipes. Oh my god, that was an innovate!
Oh, the Drake innovate swipe would have happened, but he did choose to use the Drake last turn instead of the Sludge Belcher. Which means it may be back on the plan that we saw previously of the double swipe turn this turn.
Will it? It will generate the minion from the Voidcaller, and you're not able to kill either a Doomguard, either a Mul'Ganis. Unless you trade with both of your minions.
So you can swipe the Voidcaller first, right? And then if Mul'Ganis comes out, then you can swipe the Loetheb, deal 1 damage to the Mul'Ganis, but then the 1-3s are still in the way because they will have got buffed from the Mul'Ganis being summoned.
Exactly.
So yeah, it's going to be a little bit awkward. Right.
Trade of the Claw? No, Belcher's better than Trade of the Claw.
Yeah,
Belcher double trade, hero power. Or...
Yeah.
Well, no, Wildcrow doesn't do anything because you're at 9 mana, so you have 11. So you can play Druid of the Claw, swipe, and hero power. That's about it.
Right. It looks like Lifecoach is all in on these greedy shades. Very, very interesting seeing this happen against an aggressive matchup, because usually this is something that you get punished for, like waiting too long to reveal your Shade of Naxxramas against other aggressive decks. And they just out-temper you while you're waiting for your minions to grow. But Lifecoach really hasn't just been presented with too many good opportunities to make the trades. I think this was a potential turn he could have done it while he was protected behind the Sludge Belcher. Mm-hmm. But I guess he's scared of the implications of a Doomguard coming out of that Voidcaller and getting generating another possible attack for his opponent.
I wonder. Will AKAWonder trade with the low tap here to the Belcher? It looks clean, right? But it goes well to the double swipes.
Yeah, I was going to say, it feels like this might be the best value you're going to get out of your owl. The value on your opponent's side of the board has just got so huge with the size of those two shades that I think you're going to need to push some damage aggressively to face this turn.
Oh, I know why Lifecoach did make the wild grow, because if he top decks a Savage Roar, now that's 13 and 6, 23, so that's one of lethal with the swipes. Huh, so it wouldn't have been a lethal setup.
Still, I mean, double swipe in hand is going to be able to answer most of this board, but we're kind of in the same situation as we were last term, where, you know, Lifecoach just doesn't know what's going to come out of that Voidcaller, and it could have some serious implications as to whether he's able to come back into this board. But the double swipe is just way too clean here. Wait,
what?
Swiping fast. I was going to say, you have to swipe one of the taunts, right? Yeah.
So now we can use Innervate to kill the 1-1. You have to do it, right? Otherwise, you're not able to attack with double shades. And pushing 12 damage to the face?
Yeah, I mean, we have to do it, right? You have to do at least that 7 to face. The option to trade with the Imgang boss is there if you want to really play around potential beats. But I love putting 12 to face here, and that looks like what Lifecoach is going to do.
And the Dr. Boom is not something you want. But you're pushed to use the Implosion here, right? If you don't want to die next turn.
Yep, if you don't want to tap, And if you don't want to, if you don't want to tap and you don't want to die, then implosion is your only option. But AKAWonder might feel like he's going to need to tap at some point during this game if he's going to win it. In which case, that tap might as well be now. So he is going to go ahead and do it. Flame Imp, as always in this situation, is the card you draw. He's going to go ahead and implosion. But even if he does roll three or above, which he doesn't, okay. Well, we'll put him out of his misery nice and quickly at least.
Yep. So this equalizes the series. It's 2-2 between Lifecoach and AKAWonder, and the decider match now we would play between those two players. It's interesting to see that the only games that Lifecoach won were because there were two swipes in his hand.
Yeah, it's very true. And in both games, both swipes were used in the same turn. So
It seems like the way you win the matchup, right?
Yeah. Turns out double swipe is pretty good on turn 7 or 8 or so against Zoo. So yeah, again, Lifecoach hits the Wild Growth Shade combination with the coin. He's been so...
And he has a wrath. And this time he has a big game hander. Will he keep it?
Seems unlikely. I mean, the rest of his hand is really good. So it's the kind of hand where you have enough cards that you can carry sort of one situational card in your hand just to have it when you need it. But yeah, I mean, you can definitely consider keeping it with your plan being coin Wild Growth and then Shade on 3 and then probably some combination of Wrath on turn 4 unless you draw a Shredder. So, oh, sorry, on the 4 mana turn, not turn 4.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Probably the Big Game Hunter is less important than the Keepers. And
yeah,
than the Druid of the Claw and the Swipe. And never mind.
Yeah, he's gonna keep it. He sent back the Wrath and kept the Big Game Hunter.
I'm really surprised by sending out the Wrath. Right?
Yeah, it's really interesting. I guess he just doesn't see the turn where he's gonna play that card, considering the curve that he's looking at, but just keeping Wrath in your hand as a utility against this deck just seems really powerful because, you know, if you just need to deal with a Knife Juggler or something like that, then...
That's the go-to card.
Yeah, exactly.
So, in this scenario, when you have a coin and an invite, I guess you need to coin Wild Growth this turn unless you need a 3-3 minion next turn. So, you have to evaluate... the possible outcomes from your opponent. If he plays a 3-2 minion next board next turn, you don't have a Wrath, so you will not unshade and unstealth. If he plays a Dark Peddler, then you can kill it, but you'll be vulnerable to a Mortal Coil from the Peddler, which is a huge probability.
Yes.
And, that's an interesting choice. But I guess the safest thing is to just coin the Wild Growth, right? Because then you're gaining the... Wait, what? Double white growth?
Just gonna, yeah, turn one double wild growth.
Okay, this is something I didn't anticipate at all.
So he's gonna give himself 4 mana next turn, and I don't really see why he needs to have 4 mana right now. I mean, he could have coined one wild growth, he could have played the shade next turn, which is exactly the same thing as he's going to do this turn. And then he could have also had an innovate in his hand at the cost of having one less total mana. There is the Mortal Coil, yeah. Obviously, class cards are 4 times more likely, I believe,
yes,
to be offered in Discover Mechanics than neutral cards. So you do get your class spells with a much higher consistency than you might expect.
I guess you give yourself the Mortal Coil unless you value the 2-1 minion more. Might not be bad to just pick the tournament attendee.
Yeah, it kind of feels like swipe food, though, right? You've been swiped so often in this game that...
Soulfire! So the weapon against Azure Drakes.
Well, I mean, I guess that's a reason to give yourself 4 mana on turn 1.
Sounds good.
Yeah, I mean, Lifecoach is a prophet, apparently. He just sees the future, knows that he's going to top deck the Piloted Shredder, slams it down on 4 mana there, and now he has Shredder next round.
Wow, second Mortal Coil. I just wanted to say that AKAWonder would really love to have that Mortal Coil right now in their hand.
He would, yeah. Absolutely.
Wait, why is he thinking? You need to trade with the Piloted Shredder, right?
I think so. I mean, unless the plan is just to play the Voidwalker to wall it out, but... Yeah, it's an interesting point, actually, because you saw your opponent very deliberately ramp themselves to 4 mana on the previous turn. So on playing the Dark Peddler the first time, you feel like maybe you were expecting the Shredder and would have taken the Mortal Coil. Ah, he's just going to Soulfire the Shredder. Loses the Void Caller, though. Okay. So, I mean, I guess his plan here is just to try and outvalue the Druid for throughout the first few turns and try and starve him of cards, because he did spend, four cards on the
first turn? Really count the coin.
Right, so like 3.5 cards were used on the first turn, yeah.
But it doesn't look good for Lifecoach. Like, he has the mana advantage by 2 crystals each turn, but how do you utilize that? If you only have a big game hunter and a Savitar on your hand. Right. If an example, he picks a 7-drop right now, it's quite useless. Oh, okay.
Oh my god.
Well, if you go on curve right like that, then sure, it's correct.
So, he had basically nothing in hand after that turn one play, right? He had a Shadowknack Rammus and a big game hunter. He picked up the Piloted Treader on his 4-mana turn, which was perfect. The turn that he whiffed with his 5-mana turn, which was a nice turn for just Shade of Max Ramus hero power anyway. And then he picked up Emperor on his 6-mana turn. So Lifecoach's deck has definitely decided to be a little bit kind to him in this deciding game in the series against AKAWonder here. And as you said, there was an issue without those top decks coming out that he was going to have trouble spending this mana that he'd given himself. But for now, that Emperor looks like it's creating a pretty solid state of the board right now. Is he going to triple trade into the Emperor? Wow!
Well, you don't know what the opponent has in his hand, right?
And there's 2 cards!
Yes, but you saw them from the beginning of the game. If then you see them from the beginning of the game, and your opponent double ramps, and he uses the top decks each single turn, that means he has valuable cards in the hand, right? That's the assumption you make.
I mean, yes, sure, I follow that logic, but I think even if my opponent's hand was face up with, like, Force of Nature Savage Roar in the hand right there, I don't think I'm ever going to triple trade into that Emperor. It's just, it's way too much value to give your opponent. Like, how do you intend to win in that situation if you're just giving an Emperor Thorasan triple Wind Fury and Taunt? Like, just... it's insane.
That's a good metaphor. Yeah. I mean, sorry, comparison.
Yeah, anyway.
Imagine swipe.
Swipe would have been glorious, and the way Lifecoach has been drawing, it wouldn't surprise me, but for the first time in a while, he does whiff on a draw here, and the Living Roots comes down.
Is it such a whiff?
I mean, it's 1 mana to spend out of the 8 that he has, so I guess in that sense it's a whiff, but it's pretty useful in this situation, I guess. Not the end of the world.
Yeah. Oh my god.
Alright, I mean, we're just going for Savage Roar Lethal.
Yeah.
Then, right?
That tells your opponent what do you have in hand.
Yeah.
No way you're gonna make that play when you don't have a Savage Roar in your hand and your opponent can use a Implosion for that 4-2.
Absolutely. Knife Juggler not gonna help out a great deal here. He's gonna snipe down those 3-1s.
There's the Haunted Creeper.
The Haunted Creeper is going to help out, yeah, but he needs to really do a lot more work than this. He would have needed, like, Knife Juggler and Implosion, I think.
You go for the Knife... I mean, if you sacrifice this minion, then you want to play Defender of Argus. If you Defender of Argus, you need to play Voidwalker anyway. So you toned up the Egg and the Haunted Creeper. But if you go for the Knife Juggler, you have 3 juggles, which can help with the Big Game Hunter and the 1-1s. The odds are greater on the Knife Juggler than the passive Defender of Argus, right?
I think so. I mean, his tap into the Argus there, I think if he'd have picked up another small minion, then the Knife Juggler play would have been obvious, but I think that Defender of Argus has just tilted his thinking. He does get 3 taunts into play here, which is probably good enough to protect him from lethal this turn.
No.
Well, never mind.
Oh my god. Okay, let's say that just right now. Lifecoach was ridiculously lucky with his draws this game.
I'm glad you're the one to say that. I guess as your teammate, you're allowed to just put that out there. But yeah, the top decks were real in that game for sure. Top deck Shredder on his 4-mana turn, Emperor on his 6-mana turn, Living Roots to set up the Savage Roar lethal, and then just rips the Force of Nature off the top for combo on his 9-mana. So
ridiculous when you think about it. That was really ridiculous. Like this game, Innervate Coin, double White Growth, turn 1. And from then you're just like, yes, let's do this. Let's draw the cards from the top of the deck. Let's rip those minions and just fill out the curve.
Yeah, I mean, that's what that kind of play is. It's putting faith in your deck as a druid to draw you a high-value minion every turn, which is kind of what the deck is built to do. It's moved a little bit more away from that recently because you're squeezing in like the extra Living Roots and you have those Wrath, Swipe, Force of Nature, Savage Roar, etc. that's always been in the deck, but generally, there's just like a big bulky pack of mid-range minions in the middle of the deck that you can draw from, and that's exactly what Lifecoach did, picking up essentially the perfect one for sort of 3 turns out of 4 or something like that, and that was good enough to win the unfavored matchup, take down AKAWonder, and Lifecoach is now our third semi-finalist, Lothar.
Yep, and the next matchup that we'll have today will be between Super JJ and Gara, and Garo won on the back of his Kazan Mystic yesterday, but he will be facing a rogue player. So that card will be useless.
A role player or a rogue player?
Same thing.
Yeah, okay.
Anyway, we're going to in for a short break. Don't go anywhere, guys. This is the fourth quarterfinals that we'll have in a few minutes after the break of G2 Esports Class Legends. We'll be right back.